Good morning, Trinity.
Good morning.
I don't know, God's been putting something in my head the last couple weeks, and when I say good morning, Trinity, I'm not leaving out visitors, because once you enter this building, you're a part of Trinity. So that's why I say good morning, Trinity, because we're all worshiping together this morning, even if we're not members and we're just guests here. So please don't feel offended if I say that. Welcome to this time of worship. This morning, Pastor Jim is with us again in one of his very bold stoles, although he doesn't have the little thing in the back, so we can't. Oh, it does? Okay, we won't go there. But Pastor Matt is really sick. He went to Atlanta for a meeting and came home, and he's really sick. So that's why Pastor Jim's here today. So please say a prayer for Pastor Matt that he gets better. Aaron Watson is doing our announcements this morning, so let's watch.
Good morning, happy Sunday, and welcome to Trinity. Whether you're here in person for the first time, a longtime member, or you're just here online, we're so excited to have you here at Trinity today. We love knowing who is here in our congregation, so if you could take a quick minute to fill out the Connect card in front of you, or this tech-savvy crew here at Trinity now has it to where you can text to church to let us know you're there. All of the information to text to church is available in your bulletin, so go ahead, pull out your phone, and let us know that you're here. Tuesday, May 14th at 6:30, we're going to be having our Called Charge Conference. If you've heard us talk a little bit about the town hall meetings that have been taking place here at Trinity, this is your opportunity as a church member to have a voice, and most importantly, to have a vote. So come on out for the Called Charge Conference, Tuesday, May 14th at 6:30 in the sanctuary. If you want to come out for a great time of Bible study or just to ask Pastor Matt a bunch of questions, that's allowed too, come out for Bibles and Brews. This takes place on the first Monday of every month, and you can meet at Three Keys Brewery and Eatery out on State Road 64. Again, come out for Bibles and Brews, first Monday of the month. Parents, in case you were not aware, and we are aware, summer is coming. June 3rd through 7th, we are going to be hosting Vacation Bible School here at Trinity. If you've never been a part of this awesome, awesome adventurous week, we would love to see your kiddos come out for VBS. You can go online and register your child at trinitybradenton.com. And we're also going to need your help as a church for donations to come in to support the Vacation Bible School effort. So keep an eye out for that supply list, which should be coming next week. Thank you so much for joining us here at Trinity today. If you want to find out more about what we have going on in the life of our church, you can find us across social media at Trinity Bradenton, or for the most information you can possibly find, go to trinitybradenton.com. We hope you have a beautiful and blessed week.
His name is Master, Savior, Lion of Judah, Blessed Prince of Peace, Shepherd, Fortress, Rock of Salvation. Lamb of God is He, Son of David, King of the Ages, Eternal Life, Holy Lord of Glory. His name is Life. Amen?
Amen.
Let us join in worship now as we receive the prelude.
Didn't you feel like saying that?
Yes.
Nobody knows the trouble I've seen. But all night, all day, angels watching over me. Two great ones to put together, huh? Our first hymn, Sing Praise to God, was written a couple of centuries ago. But the language in it could have been written today, because it talks about God being there wherever you are. Even though he reigns above, he is our best friend who walks with us day by day and takes care of us as if a mother taking care of her children. I thought that was very interesting, to be an older hymn and still having that vision of God covering us and taking care of us as a mother takes care of her children. Let's stand and sing praise to God.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended to heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence you shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Ask you to turn and greet each other in the name of Christ, and if you chance it, give somebody a hug.
Well, did you get your hugs in? You need 8 every day. If you don't get 8, you don't grow. You stagnate. So how many of you are starting to grow? Some of you. You got some work to do. You do want to pray for Pastor Matt. He's probably listening. Maybe he is, maybe he isn't. When he and I talked with each other on Friday morning, he sounded like a bad frog. He really was sick. And so we pray that he is on the mend, and then he will be back with us soon. We want to lift up, besides Pastor Matt, these other prayer concerns for Myra Choate, Billy Dean, Lori Fitzer, Jim Friend Sr., Kathy Goodfellow, Kenny Hawkins Jr., Mary Hittner, Howard Longstreet, Tina Rinke, Bob Vogelsong, Gloria Warren, and Jeff has asked a prayer of thanksgiving because there is now, the first time in 57 years in his family, they now have a new boy in that family, 7 pounds, 7 ounces, Cohen. Yay! He's relieved. He's relieved. We also want to pray for those in our community who have yet to come to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And when I say that, I mean this body as well, the body of Christ. Let us pray. Most holy and gracious God, we come into your sanctuary in great anticipation that we are going to meet you here today. We come with hearts rejoicing, and yet some of us come with hearts that are struggling, seeking answers, looking for hope, longing for possibilities in our lives. In the darkness of our lives, in the valleys of our existence, may we discover the hope. And may we hear your voice. We give thanks to you for all the blessings that you have bestowed upon us. Sometimes they're easy to forget, to ignore, just to assume that they're there. And yet, in hindsight, we see how you have blessed us each step of the way. And for that, we are thankful. We thank you for this opportunity to be together in your church. Help us not to take it for granted. Worship is a gift that sometimes we just assume will always be there. But as Christians in China and parts of Africa, they're discovering that the government can come in and blow up the places of worship and place the pastors and staff in jail. And so we would pray for those who are under distress today, that they will not lose hope and that they will become stronger because of your guidance. Lord, you have given us the Easter song, and hallelujah is on our lips. And we give you praise now in the name of Jesus, praying as he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The ushers come now to wait upon us as we wait upon the Lord, as we present to God God's tithes and our offerings. This is a holy time, a high time, a holy privilege time as we are able to give to God what he has already given to us. Let us pray. Receive now this gift, O Lord, and bless it with your presence. Multiply it mightily, for we place it into the work of your kingdom here on earth through this church. And we do it all in the name of Christ and for his sake. Amen.
next song is kind of a short chorus, but such a powerful message. It says, open our eyes and our ears. Let us sing. Please be seated.
Good morning. This morning we're going to read from Matthew 16 through verses 13 to 16. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, who do people say the Son of Man is? They replied, some say John the Baptist, but others say Elijah, and still others, Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. But what about you? He asked. Who do you say I am? Simon Peter answered, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. The Word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Art. Would you join me in prayer? We never take your presence for granted, God. And so we would ask you now intentionally to be here and speak, so that we will know it is you that is speaking. And may these who have gathered here see the teacher and not this teacher. In the name of Christ, amen. It was in the Vatican City some years ago, when the Catholic merchants were disturbed by the fact that their city was being overtaken by Jewish merchants. The Jewish merchants' business were thriving, the Catholic merchants were struggling. And so the Catholic merchants turned to the cardinals who were in session at the time and said, we don't know what to do about this situation. It's horrible. And the cardinals said, well, we'll go to the Jewish merchants and see what we can do to see maybe they can move their business someplace else. So they went to the merchants and tried to present their case on behalf of the Catholic merchants. And the Jewish merchant says, no, I'm sorry, we're going to stay right here. We're not going to move our business anyplace. Freedom is freedom. And so the cardinals came back and reported that, their situation. And they said, we don't know what else to do. And so they said, let us take it to the Holy Father. He is so wise and so wonderful and insightful. And so they went to the Pope and presented the situation. And the Pope listened carefully. And he says, well, maybe if I would go as an ambassador for my fellow merchants, my fellow Catholics, and maybe they would listen to me. So he went on their behalf and presented the case to them. And the Jewish merchants said, in all due respect, the answer is no, we stay. The Pope thought for a minute and he says, could we could we put this to a debate? I've got to have a solution. Would it be possible to debate the issue? And the Jewish merchant says, yeah, that would be kind of fair. And then the Pope said, and I will judge who wins. If the Catholic merchants win, you leave. If you win, you stay. They weren't too sure about that, but they said, you are an honest and holy man, so we will honor that. And then the Pope said, and it will be a silent debate. Well, the cardinals heard about this, and they were beginning to contemplate who was going to argue their side, and as the case would be, they said, there's nobody better than the Pope himself, so the Pope will argue our side. But the Jewish merchants were not as free to make those decisions, because there wasn't a synagogue in the city, and there was no resident rabbi, and so they didn't know what to do. And they talked among themselves, and so they turned to an Old Testament, what we would call an Old Testament concept of throwing lots. And the lots fell on 89-year-old Hiram, hunchback. He was a tailor in his homemade suits. And his reaction to that, "Hoy, I don't know what to do. I know nothing. I am just a humble tailor. But if that's what God wants, what am I to ask, question God?" So the day of the debate came. The auditorium was filled. The Pope comes onto the stage in all of his finery. And old Hiram, 89-year-old Hiram, shuffles out. They look at each other. And the Pope says, to which Hiram says, the Pope, he says, Hiram says, and the Pope thought for a long moment and walks off the stage and comes back carrying a silver tray on which was a chalice and a loaf of bread. And Hiram looks, reaches in his back pocket and pulls out an apple. The Pope says, "This old man argues well. I declare that they are the winners, and the merchants, Jewish merchants, gets to stay." Well, you can imagine the hubbub in the auditorium. And the Jews left exuberant, and all the Catholic in the audience came storming the stage. "Oh, Holy Father, what did you say? What was the meaning?" He said, "You know, I opened up with God is everywhere." And this little man says, "Yes, but the God who is everywhere is still right here." And then I said, "And we know the God who is here in three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit." And then he says, "Yes, but he is still one." And then I said, "We know the one in the body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ." And then he says, "Yes, but sin is still present." Now, outside the auditorium in another part of the city, all the Jews run to Hiram and says, Hiram, what went on?" He said, "I don't know. That man in the funny clothes said, all Jews have got to leave the city." And I says, "No, we're staying right here." And then he says, "You've got 3 days to get out of town." And I said, "Not one Jew is going to leave." And then he showed me his lunch and I showed him mine. That's my best story. I preached once up in Michigan and told that story, and they invited me back 2 years later to preach a revival, provided that I would tell that story again. But it illustrates the fact that everything that we are involved in is a matter of interpretation, isn't it? Jesus turns to his disciples and asks that pertinent question, "Who do you say that I am?" And they said, "You know, some are saying you're John the Baptist. Some are saying you are Elijah. Some Jeremiah or one of the prophets." That illustrates the fact that there was great confusion as to just who this Jesus is. That should bring great comfort to you and me, because at times in our own journey, we get confused as to who he is, don't we? That was not a rhetorical question. I don't know about you, but I get confused. I don't have it nailed down. I don't think Matt has it nailed down. Rick doesn't have it nailed down. It's hard. It's confusing. What, you know, where are we going? And then it dawned on me, it begins with a who. He says, "Who do you say I am?" Who? The year was 1965, September the 3rd. The place was Allapattah Methodist Church. Charlie Thompson stood before that gathering of about 400 to 500 individuals. He had just come on as our pastor from being president of the Children's Home in Enterprise, Florida. And before him stood two very naive young people, one Margaret Marie Seaver and one James Wesley Martin. And on that Friday evening, we became husband and wife. Oh, if I had only known what I was getting involved in. It was a who. Oh, I was so in love with being in love. And I was in love with the whole idea of marriage. I was just, you know, enamored with that whole concept. What I didn't realize then, and what I have tried to impress upon people that I have counseled for marriage, is that you're not marrying a concept or an idea. You're marrying a real life human being, and you're marrying all their foibles and all their pain and angst and all of that. That's a real life person. And later on, 6 months to 6 years later, you're going to look at them and say, "This person isn't going home. This is not a long date." That's reality. The Reverend Dr. Dean Martin, when he was pastoring the church up in Trinity, up in Gainesville, Trinity United Methodist Church, he taught a course on good marriages don't just happen. And in the course of that, he talked about his love for Sandy, his wife. And he says, "Let me tell you a reality. There are days here and the days there. There's weeks here and weeks there. And there's months here and months there that it would just be more simple and easier on me if I just took her to the tallest mountain, push her off, and tell God she slipped." You think about it. You know? Living with somebody else is hard. And Jesus says, "Who am I for you?" There's things about Jesus we're not going to like. There are things that he's going to ask us to do and get involved in that we would prefer not to do. Jesus is demanding. Christianity is not for wimps. It's hard. You don't believe me? Just turn to your enemy and say, "I love you. I'm willing to sacrifice myself for you. I'm willing to die for you." How many of us are willing to do that? Not very many. But that's exactly what Jesus is asking us to do. And by the way, we're not in love with a denomination. We're not in love with the concept of the kingdom of God. We're not in love with the gospel. We're in love with a person by the name of Jesus Christ. Our relationship is with Jesus. Amen? I mean, I get exasperated when people come up to me and say, you know, I don't know about my kids. I took them to church. I took them to NYF. I got them involved in Sunday school. And now that they're adults, they don't have anything to do with church. Where did I go wrong? And I look at them and say, since you've asked, you introduced them to church. You didn't introduce them to Christ. You need to introduce people to Jesus Christ, not to a concept, not to an idea, not to a theology, not to a denomination. It's a who. Why don't we get that? It's a who. And then he goes on to say, who do you what? Say I am. Now, the word say in the Greek does not translate well into English. Because when you hear the word say, my assumption is that what you are hearing is verbiage, what comes out of your mouth, right? It's not. Let me change your paradigm on that one. There are concentric circles at the very core of your being. Is spirit. That's that part of God that he gives to you when he created you into a human being. He breathed into you, the pneumos of God. He breathed into you the breath of God. That's the spirit. That's that part of God that you carry around in your heart and your being. Next to the spirit, the next circle out, is your soul. Your soul is what is unique to you. You walk up to somebody and you can identify who they are, not by the color of their hair, but by their soul, their uniqueness. And then you have your emotions and your mental and your physical and all those other things. When you strip everything away and you come down to the soul, that's the seat of your being. Got it? What do you say at the very seat of your being? When you strip all that other stuff away, at the very core of your existence, what do you say? Who are you? That's where it's at. And that's where the challenge comes. Now, I don't know what Matt was going to preach on Habakkuk. But I was intrigued with the idea that there are times in our lives when God seems to be very silent and very far away. For me, was when the DS called and said, Jim, you're moving to a church in South Florida. And I didn't understand that. I mean, I had been at Gainesville first, and things were going extremely well. Attendance was up, professions of faith was up, giving was just out of the world. The staff parish wanted me back, the staff wanted me back, the congregation wanted me back, and yet my DS says, no, you're moving. It didn't make sense to me. It really didn't. It doesn't today. And when my pastor Waldo Faraby, who had confirmed me in the faith, walks up to me at annual conference and says, this is the biggest, stupidest decision that the cabinet has ever made. I said, amen. But I went, because that's what Methodist pastors do. But I was broken. My spirit was broken. It became a very dark moment in my life. And I had faced dark moments. We all face dark moments in our lives, don't we? And that was one of the darkest moments. Every night I seemed like I cried myself to sleep. It didn't make sense. And I had turned to one of my colleagues in my covenant group, Bill Yeager, who was called to the ministry out of that church. And I said, Bill, any suggestions that you could give me for how to handle this church? He says, yeah, Jim, take a bulldozer to it, plow it under and start all over. It's the meanest church in the annual conference. And I was just broken. And I prayed to God, And I didn't feel God was hearing my prayers. Ever been there? You pray and you pray and you pray, and all you get is what? Silence. Where are you, God, in all of this? And then I had been hearing about these events called Promise Keepers. Remember that? And there was one in Tampa, and I was finding any avenue to lift my spirit, because my spirit was broken. I couldn't get any lower emotionally and psychologically. I just couldn't. I went to the Promise Keepers event here in Tampa, and the last speaker was the coach, Coach McCartney. The coach stood up and said something that really rang true in my life. He said, "You know, over 92% of all Christian pastors standing before congregations this day would prefer to do something else in their lives." I bore witness to that. I'd rather be doing anything. And some of you have come up to me after we announced that I was going out to Manatee, and they said, "Jim, you're 76 years old. What are you doing?" And I said, "I've been in that valley of the shadow of death. And yet, in the midst of all of it, I was able to find hope." I cried all the way home from Tampa, because what he had to say resonated in the depths of my soul. I had lost all hope in the ministry. You know what that is? That's painful. And then I began to discover a lot of people in this life have lost hope. Right? You wonder where God is in all of this. You're in a bed of pain. You feel like you are in an emotional jail. And I was coming home to a congregation where I really didn't want to be, and I didn't think they loved me. And it was true, they didn't. And I was to celebrate Holy Communion with them. And that was hard. Because you see, Holy Communion is a love feast. It's a time of celebration. It's a time of being embraced by hope and discovering the hope that God has in store for you individually. And I didn't feel like celebrating Holy Communion. And I didn't. The table was set, but I didn't celebrate it. I shared with them my journey and where I was coming from. And yet we gather around this table in the hope that God has given to us in our pastors, Matt and Rick, and churches like Trinity and Manatee and Emmanuel and Faith and First, that the kingdom of God isn't through with us, and the word of hope has been buried within the depths of our soul, the core of our being. So when you hear the words, "Who do you say that I am?" what are you going to say? An idea? A concept? A church? A denomination? Or like Peter, "You are the Christ, the Messiah." That's our testimony. And that in itself gives us a hope so that we can face tomorrow. And so on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Take and feast on me in your hearts with thanksgiving." And likewise, after supper, he took a cup, and after giving thanks to God, he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, drink ye all of this, for this is my blood." You see, in Leviticus 17, it says, the life is in the blood. This is life. a symbol of life, the symbol of hope, the symbol of possibilities, the symbol of tomorrow, so that we can embrace him as Lord and Savior. And so we celebrate this cup and this bread in thanksgiving in our hearts for all that he has done for us. This is a love feast. A love feast. You are loved like nobody else in the whole world has ever been loved. Amen? And so, Lord, we give you thanks. Thanks for the bread and for this cup and for loving the likes of us and instilling in us hope when we are in that valley, when we think you are not hearing us, that we don't matter. We are just in that valley of the shadow of death. And yet you came and you gave yourself for the likes of us. Thank you, Lord. Bless now this bread and this cup, for we do it in celebration of all that you are and all that we can become. In the name of Christ, amen. And may those who are helping with communion come at this time. And as they come, let me remind you that the Methodist communion is a communion that is open to all of any age and any church relationship. You don't have to be a Methodist. You don't even have, you know, you can be confused. Most of us are. Don't know, we're not sure what we are. All we know is that there's something here for us. And so, shortly, the ushers will come and give guidance to you. And those who need to have gluten-free, that's at the little tables on either side. The body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, which is broken for you. Take, eat, and feast on him in your heart with thanksgiving. Amen. The ushers will give you direction. If for whatever reason you desire to be served in the pew, simply indicate them and one of the teams will come and serve you. Thank you. Somebody asked, what's the end of the story? The end is I'm still around, still in the ministry. That's the end of the story.
Our last song is a spiritual, I Want Jesus to Walk with Me. We're going to do three verses, and then I've asked Stephanie, because this song is very special to her, to do a final verse for us. So let's stand and sing, I Want Jesus to Walk with Me.
Take the hands of those you are standing with. And my dear friends, go in peace and go in love and go remembering and living into the reality that no matter what you're facing, what you're dealing with, the valley is not that deep or that long. He's walking with you each step of the way. Amen?
Amen. Amen.